So last time, I defined the notion of algebra, and today I will give examples. So maybe for the new incomers, I will recall this notion. So I recall that of algebra over a field K What is it? It is a K vector space. A, which is endowed with linear maps. Those are the first map, mu, eta. Delta epsilon and S so this is called the product this map is called the unit this map is called the coproduct this one the co-unit This one, the antipode. And we need axioms for this data. So such that, first axiom, A under with mu and eta is an algebra. A endowed with the coproduct and the co-unit is a co-algebra. Then we require that the coproduct and co-unit are algebra morphisms. And lastly, for the antipode, S is the convolution inverse of the identity. So this should, okay, so maybe if I denote the product, I denote it like that, like this. So if I use this notation, so the product like this, the unit like this, the coproduct, I denote it like this, the co-unit like this, and the antipode like this. And the flip like this, then I can have graphical I can rewrite the axiom in graphical terms. So maybe I make numbers. So the first axiom of an algebra means that the product is associative and unital. The axiom two means we have the coproduct is co-associative and co-unital. So the axiom three, the coproduct is an algebra morphism, means this. So it is multiplicative and unital. And the fact that the co-unit is an algebra morphism means that. And this is just the identity of the unit of the field. And finally, for the antipode to be a convolution inverse of the identity, this means this.
Okay.
So this is the notion of Hopf algebra. So we have seen this last time. So now I will give examples. So first example, so maybe the group algebra. So we take G a group, and we consider KG be the vector space. With basis G. So, and KG is a Hopf algebra. So I need to define the map. So the product. So I will define the map on the basis vector, so on the element of G, and you extend the map by linearity. So the product is on the basis just given by the product of G. So the unit map, so this is the unit element, just the unit of G. So the coproduct of an element of G is given by this, the co-unit is one, and the antipode is just the inversion. And you can verify that, so you extend this map by linearity, and then you obtain a Hopf algebra. So this is for example, and so you can verify the actions. So next example. So now we consider a finite group. And consider G be the vector space of all the functions from G to K. So this is a K vector space. So we already see that F of G is an algebra with product. So given by, if I take two functions, I want to define their product, so maybe I should call them phi psi. So for phi psi, so and G, in G it is defined, you take just a product component wise. And unit, so the unit element defined is just defined like this. the function constant equal to 1. OK, so this is an algebra. Now I want to define the structure of algebra. So we already seen that. So define delta. So since G is a finite group, we have an isomorphism like this. And so delta phi on G times I. Phi of GH. This GH. So I define the coproduct like this. The antipode, the co-unit is just evaluation at the group element. And finally, the antipode is phi of G inverse. So I define this map like this. And so this is again an algebra. This is of algebra of function on G. So I'll give another example. So the tensor algebra. So we consider a vector space. And so we have defined already the tensor algebra T of V as a vector space is a sum of the tensor power of V like this. So this is so K plus V plus V times V plus etc. I recall that the product of this is defined by V1 VK times W1. You just take the tensor product. This is for element of the vector space. And you extend this product by linearity. And unit, so the unit element is just the unit of K. You see it here. Okay, so this is an algebra. And we have seen already that Z maps from V. Linear maps. V maps to V so 1 plus 1. And for V to K, V maps to 0. They extend by a universal property of Si tu en sors l'algèbre A, tout algèbre maps OK. And also the linear map from V to tensor V up. When I put up here with opposite product, so this is a linear, so it extends to an algebra map S from T to V, T to V. So maybe I define this. V maps to negative V. So I put O because I recall that the antipode must be anti-multiplicative.
Is it to 0 or to
1? No, 0. Because you want this action, the identity delta is identity. I put epsilon here, so epsilon v 0, epsilon 1 is 1, it's an algebra morphism, so you just take v. So okay. So the end, this is an off algebra. Is it okay? I can explain again if you want. It's okay? Okay, and what we obtain, we have a structure of algebra on the tensor. Okay. So maybe no, are we okay? So, how do you construct algebra? Usually, so a nice way to construct algebra is to quotient an algebra by an ideal. And we want to do the same thing for off algebra. So we need a notion of off ideal. So, off ideal of algebra A, what is it? It's an ideal. For me, ideal are two-sided of A such that, what? So, we want that the coproduct, co-unit and antipose, and use map on the quotient. So we need to impose this. So the image of the ideal by the coproduct should belong right, so A plus A times I. The ideal should be in the kernel of epsilon and S of I. So what can we say? So then the quotient algebra. So we have an ideal. We have an algebra. this is off algebra. With coproduct delta bar co-unit epsilon bar and antipode S bar, they are characterized so by what you should imagine. So we want to define, so the coproduct like this. And what we know, we have the coproduct above. So yes, you want that this diagram is commutative. Here you have P. You have P O times P. P is just a usual projection. Okay, now if you consider this map, first delta, then P times P, this condition implies that I, the ideal is in the kernel of this map, so it factorizes like this. And you have this map. And you do the same for the other. So epsilon, you have A to K, A to I, epsilon bar, epsilon P, and the same for the antipode. P. Okay. Oops. Okay. And it is easy to verify that you do obtain an off algebra. Let's see an example. So maybe I'll take this one. Okay. So consider a Lie algebra. So maybe I call. What is it? This is a vector space, G. J. So, which is endowed with a bilinear map, the Lie bracket. And such that, so first, we want that V is 0 for all x, in the vector space. And so this will imply that C bracket is anti-symmetric. And we have the Jacobi identity. X, Y, Z. So probably you have seen this notion during the class, a master class. Okay. So we consider now, so we pick a Lie algebra, and we consider Si tensor algébra, T of G. G is a vector space, we can consider this algebra. And let I be the ideal of this algebra. Which is generated by this element. So we can x tensor y minus y tensor x minus x y and this is an off ideal. So let us verify this fact. So we need to compute the coproduct of this. So if I take two elements in the algebra, what do we have? So we need to compute. So the coproduct of this. So first we compute the coproduct of this. So how do we compute this coproduct? We know what is the form of the coproduct on the element of G, and we know that delta is a morphism of algebra. So this x multiplied by y times 1, y. And so what we obtain, so we multiply, so x, y, tensor 1, plus x, tensor y, I tensor x, plus 1, x, y. And similarly, so we have, well, this is reverse. And we have so the Lie bracket of x and y is an element of G. So we know what is its coproduct. So finally, what can we say? X tensor y tensor x. What do we obtain? So I take this minus this minus this. So this in the middle simplify. So we have xy minus yx minus so. Plus the same here, one of time and this indeed belongs and so this belongs to I of times G plus G times I. So this This works for all x, y, and so for the id generated by x, y. Is included. Okay. And this conclusion because I is an ideal and delta is multiplicative. So we have verified that. Okay. And you can verify that for the antipode and the co-unit, it works. So similarly, maybe it was okay. So we have defined an off ideal of the tensor algebra, and consequently, you can quotient the tensor algebra of the ideal. This is an off algebra. And we denote by U of G. And it is called the enveloping algebra of G. Okay. Sorry.
The coproduct always arrives in G tensor G, or
no. The coproducts arrive in T of G tensor T of G. One does not belong to G.
What is X Y?
So. This is tensor. Ah, so okay. I should put. No, this is here. This is a product of T of G tensor T of G. So you have to cross in the middle. Okay. So let's see an example. Maybe you should know the algebra SL2. So this is a matrix, 2 by 2 matrices with a trace equal to 0. And the bracket is just xy minus yx for two two matrices. So you can verify that it is the algebra. So what is the dimension of SL2? It is a so there is just one condition on the diagonal. The element, the sum of the two elements of the diagonal must be zero. So the you remove one dimension, so it is three-dimensional. And it has basis. And this matrix, so it's 0, 1, 0, 0. Let's call it F by 0, 0, 1, 0. And G is 1, 0, 0, negative 1. And you can compute. And what you have? You want to compute the Lie brackets. And so we have, so probably this, certainly this, you can verify and we compute the Lie bracket like this. So now we want to describe the U enveloping algebra of SL2. This is a tensor algebra of SL2 divided by the ideal, which says that E tensor F moins F tensor E moins G is 0. G tensor E tensor G minus 2E equals 0, and G plus 2F is 0. And so in other words, U SL2 is generated. Because at some point we forget we do not write the tensor product, so it is the algebra generated by E F G with relations E F is F G. EF minus FE is G. GE minus EG is 2E. And G GF minus FG is negative 2F. So this is the same thing, this and this. Okay, and so what are the co-products? Delta E, delta X is for X in so epsilon X 0 S of X okay. So this is enveloping algebra is of algebra structure is given this. OK. So now, we want to deform this of algebra here. So this enveloping algebra of SL2, we want to deform it and to define the quantum enveloping algebra of SL2. That's what we call quantum groups. They are deformation of enveloping algebra of Lie algebra. Okay, so here we fix, we pick some Q in complex number C, and let's ask it is different. Not plus or minus one. And we define UQ of SL2 as the algebra generated by E, F, K, and K inverse, and with the following relation. So here's the algebra over C. We work over C to the relations. And we quantify the relation of U SL2. So we have the relation. So K and K, this K inverse should be indeed the inverse of K. So we have this. Okay. We want E. KE is Q square EK. KF is Q negative 2 FK. And EF is FE. It is K minus K inverse over Q minus Q inverse.
We also want Q and B
non-zero,
right?
Yeah. So we want Q invertible and Q minus Q inverse non-zero. Okay, so okay, it's just a definition. We'll see later why it is the limit when Q goes to 1 is this enveloping algebra. But we want to define an off algebra structure so we define the co-unit and the antipode so here we need to define them on the generators and so okay so K is group like. So epsilon K is 1, epsilon K inverse is 1, S of K is K inverse, S of K inverse is K, okay. Now we need delta E. So if I take 1, okay, delta F is K inverse tensor F plus F tensor 1. So E equals 0, epsilon F equals 0, S of E should be minus E K inverse, and S of F should be minus KF. Okay. So we define this.
In the case that here we nowhere have Q, right?
No, no, on the coproduct, there is no Q. This is on a, of course, you can say a change of variable and make appear Q there, but Q is just concentrated for this presentation on the algebra structure. And so we will verify. So this, I get the value of the coproduct, co-unit, and antipode on the generators. Then you extend it to algebra homomorphism. But you need to verify that this relation is satisfied when you extend this by algebra homomorphism. So we will see this after the break. And then we will see how to construct solutions of the Young-Baxter equation from algebra, and in particular from this one.
Okay. So we see after the break.
Okay. So here we want to define these maps. So here I add opposite and extend, and we extend this map. To algebra morphisms. We define the generator lattice. We extend them by algebra homomorphism. To show that this is possible, we need to verify that the relations are compatible with this extension. So let's take, I don't know, so the first one. So from indeed, we have delta KE. So this delta K, delta E, is what? K tensor K. E plus E tensor K. So it is equal to K tensor E plus K E tensor K. K tensor KE as a k squared. Now we do the same, delta ek plus e. And we obtain k.
Sorry, over there, everywhere when we have product, we mean the we can imagine the tensor product there, or
yes, it's a notion of algebra with an interrelation. You can realize it by the tensor algebra divided by the ideal, corresponding to the relation. But to save notation, at some point, we do not write the tensor product because it's too. We just write it when we live in two space like this. Okay. K tensor ek plus ek tensor k square. So, and now we can we compute this minus it is k tensor ke minus k square ek plus ke k square, and so it is indeed zero. This is zero and this is zero, and so it is zero. And so it is okay. And so we can verify that all the relations are preserved by this definition. And so this is well defined. Okay. And so we obtain that UQ SL2 is off-hashable. And okay. So SL2 is the Lie algebra of the Lie group capital SL2. And that's why we call this is a quantum group. This is not a group, but of algebra. But well, that's the philosophy. Okay, so maybe I make a remark. Okay. We have so we have differentiation. We have this, the limit when q goes to one, and in some sense k goes to one of uq or fsl2 is just the enveloping algebra of sl2. That's why we have say this, this is a one parameter deformation of USL2. Maybe to see this, set G is K minus K inverse over Q minus Q inverse. Okay. In the algebra, we put this. And so we compute. Then GE minus EG, and you compute. I leave you the details of the computation and what we obtain. It is Q EK plus K inverse I and G F is F G is this minus Q inverse of F K plus K inverse F. Okay, you compute and you have this. I leave you this as an exercise. And then you can see, then you see that UQ SL2 is isomorphic to this algebra with a tilde, so generated by K inverse E F G and the relation the same, so you have K. So E, so K E is E square E K, K F, F K. Now we have one more generator, so we have E F minus F E is G. EG minus so GE minus EG is Q plus K inverse F. And probably I should add G and K should commute. GK. Okay, so you can verify this. And the verification comes from this computation here. So, and now we have that this algebra is well defined. I should say this one. So I should add this relation. So it should be this. And Q inverse G is K minus K inverse. And this implies a GK commute. Okay. And this is well defined. Also, when Q is 1, and minus 1 also. Because here we did not divide by Q minus Q inverse. And now, what do you remark here? So, what for U1? If I plug Q is 1, and so I can take this algebra for 1. If I take 1, I take say K minus K should be equal to Q inverse. But here you have GF minus FG is negative 2F, this, so if I divide by K is 1, by the ideal, so I put K, capital K is 1, and Q is 1, so this is done, so E equal to EF equal to F, so EF minus FG, FE is G, and GE minus EG is 2E, and GF minus FG is negative 2F. And this is indeed USL2, the enveloping algebra of SL2. That's why this is a one parameter deformation. So this explains this, this sentence. Okay. So we'll come back later with this example, but now I explain a general procedure to produce solution of the Young-Baxter equation. Okay, so I don't know, maybe five. Solution of the Young-Baxter equation from of algebra. Okay. So maybe I recall that a linear map F from V. So V is a vector space, and a linear map F from the square of V, tensor square of V to itself, is a satisfy the solution, the Young-Baxter, satisfy the Young-Baxter equation if we have this. So F O times I dv O times F I dv is equal to I dv O times F Okay. So this is the Young-Baxter equation. And we have seen already that such solutions provide an invariant of tangles with additional structure. We have operator invariant. We define operator invariant of tangles. So the main point is how to obtain such solution. Maybe I make a remark. So the flip map So U tensor V maps to V tensor U. The flip map is a solution. But it is not interesting from the point of view of invariant of links and knots because it is involutive. The inverse Okay. Now I pick alpha algebra A. So and here, for technical reason, we assume that the antipode is invertible as a linear map. And actually, you can show that this is always the case when A is finite dimensional. So the antipode of a finite dimensional of algebra is always invertible. But here, we do not assume finite dimensionality of A, so okay. So now I take, let M, and I do another remark. So in this section, I fix off algebra like this. So if M is an A module, then the flip map is not, so this flip map is not a linear. Unless the coproduct is co-commutative. Delta op is just.
So that's also tau
AA. So yes, thanks. No, M. So the flip map for M is not a linear. So what we want to do, we want to deform the flip map to obtain an alinear solution of the Young-Baxter equation. So, and this solution will not be, in general, involutive. So it's a good news for the perspective of invariant of knots. Okay, so this we need a notion of an R matrix. So an R matrix for R of algebra is an element R in A tensor A, which verifies this such that, okay. I don't want to R delta delta. So R delta A is delta op A R for all A in A. Second, delta tensor identity of A of R is R13R3. We explain the notation. Identity of A, so delta of R is R13R12. Just verify the axiom and then 1, 3, 2, 3, okay. And finally, we had this condition, epsilon. Okay. Well, so we'll see later why we require this. So here, if we denote R is sum from I Si tensor Ti. What is R13? So R13 is, so let's say begin there, 1, 2 is R O times the identity, this is S. This is A tensor A tensor A. R23 is 1 tensor R. OK. And now R13, I put the element of R in position 1 and 3. So this means sum of I. So Si tensor 1 tensor Ti. And here the product means the product in this algebra. I recall that the product of two algebra is an algebra. The tensor product of two algebra is an algebra. And here the product is in. OK. Maybe it's better to see this in graphical notation. I will take R. I will denote like this. R. So the first action, what does it say? I take delta so I multiply delta with R. So this is a product in A tensor A, I just cross and take the product, is equal to delta op. First I take delta op and R. So delta op just delta with the flip, and then I take the product in A tensor A. So this is the first action. The second action, you say what? So I take R and put the coproduct on the second component. And should be equal to R13 2 3. So R so this is 13, this is 2 3, the product like this. Okay. Okay. The third one in graphical notation is if I take R and plug the coproduct on the first component, what I obtain is 1 3. This 1 3 2 3. No, no, yeah. 1 3, okay.
Excuse me?
Oui, oui. Yeah, it's just.
You should not say rather that R lives in A tensor A star because.
No. I will see why. I verify the notation. Two, three. One, three. No, this is, so I want 1, 3. So R. R, so. Okay, so 1, 3, 1, 2. Ah. Okay, we will see how the good axiom. If I. We will see where this axiom comes from. Maybe I make a mistake here. So, anyway.
Product is on the second slope of R.
Ah.
Yes.
Yeah, thanks. So. Okay. Okay. So we'll see the axiom. Anyway, the axiom comes from somewhere, so we'll verify the axiom later. And so the third axiom is just if I put R. A co-unit, just the unit, and just with the co-unit. Okay. So maybe I will need to correct the action. Let us see. So. So first, we need some property, which is the following. So. R is invertible in A, tensor A, with inverse compute like this with antipode and in particular, this implies that S is invariant under the antipode. Okay, so let us prove this. So set, so R prime is entity R and R prime prime is identity times S inverse R. Okay, so we compute R prime times R. It is you have R, the antipode, R. And then I take the product in A tensor A. Okay. Now I look. So L 1, 3. So this is, yeah, maybe I'm. This is the diagram. So delta I do R is R1, 3, R2, 3. So it should be certainly this. So R1, 3, R2, 3. So that's where I made the mistake. So otherwise, it's correct. 1, 3, 2, 3. I did write later R2, 3, 1, 3. Okay. Okay. Now we use this. You know that this part here is exactly. Put this antipode here, this part. This part is exactly this one. And so this is equal by 2 to, so I replace, I have a coproduct A. No, here I can use the action of the antipode A. And this, by the absorption, this is just the unit. Okay, so this means that R prime is the left inverse of R. No, and if you calculate R times R prime prime, so, and you find again this. Since R is invertible from the left and from the right, thus it is invertible, and by uniqueness of the inverse, invertible, and R inverse, again, R prime. Okay. So we have shown this. And now here, if you plug in this equality, if you plug S on the right, you just find this. It's quite clear. Okay. And now, we can deform. We will deform the flip map using this R. For A module, on the left. M and N define, we define this map as follow. By so I take R, I have M, I have N. Like this, from M N to N tensor M. And here, where I did not like this, A, M, M. Here you have A, A. A, M, M is the action of M, and the same for N. Okay, what does it mean? It's just graphical, useful graphical notation. That is, if I take M in M and N in capital N, C M N of M tensor N is the sum for I T I N S I M, where R I S I. Okay, this is exactly the same thing. Okay, so we define this map and we have the following properties. What can you so first, so CMN is A linear? Si Mn is invertible with inverse it defined like this. So you take n m to m n, and just here you use the action of the inverse of the R matrix. And so for A module MNP, what do I have?
Yeah, yeah.
Si M tensor NP and si M N tensor P, so it is equal to si M P times identity of N, identity of M times CNP, N times CMP, CMN, identity of P. And in particular, for an A module M, si MM is nine. So we know this linear invertible solution of the Young-Baxter equation. And so if we have an R matrix and A module, we have solution of the Young-Baxter equation. And this is a very nice way to construct solution of the Young-Baxter equation. Okay, maybe I just begin to prove this fact. And of course, to simplify, we will use graphical notation. So we want to prove first that C is A linear. So what does it mean? This means that if I take, so we have that C M N from M tensor N to N tensor M. So we want to see that this map is compatible with the action of A on M tensor N and N tensor M. So what is the action by definition of M tensor N? We take the coproduct like this. So this is the action of A on M tensor M. We need to see if this is C M N. So you have N M, M N, N M, and A. We want to verify these things. So we need to check. It's not difficult, but now, this by definition is what? This is R. I will maybe write that. Okay. So the first, so one. This is two. So one is by definition of C. This map, we use R. And then the flip map. And here we use the coproduct. Okay. Now, what does it mean that is an action? What does it mean that we have an action? This means that if I take twice the action of A, it's the same thing. I just take the product of A and then the action. So here I can use this action here. So what to obtain? I have R, the coproduct. Then I multiply this and this. And I take the action here, and the flip up. I just use this action twice. Now, we have an action that R delta is equal to delta up R. This is the first action. So now you take the coproduct. And the flip map. Now, again, I use that this is an action. I use this action in the reverse sense. So this is. Now, again, I use this action twice. So what I obtain is
The
first action, which says that R delta is delta op R. This is the action one of an R matrix. Then, so we finish this computation. Here I use, so I have. So what if do R? Then I use like this. And so you can see this is equal to R. Take the flip map, and then okay, this is correct, and which is indeed exactly two. So we have verified that the map C is a linear. And so you verify the other property this way, using the axiom of. And in particular, we obtain a solution of Young-Baxter equation. So next time, I will explain how to produce such R. Because, OK, we have some notion of R matrix, but how to construct R matrices. And this may be done using the. So notion of a quantum double of algebra defined by Drinfeld. And then we apply to UQSL2 to obtain the Young-Baxter solution giving the Jones polynomial. OK. Maybe I stop.
Can I ask, is there some general procedure how to deform those enveloping algebras of Lie algebras to.
So you can deform the enveloping of zero of Lie algebra. So this is the theory of quantum groups, but there is no general procedure for other families of Hopf algebra. We know to define enveloping algebra of Lie algebras.
But for this, there is a procedure?
Sorry?
For this thing, there is a like for
yeah, we define like this by generator relation.
Okay.
So, no. Okay.